Christ, he ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saves you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saves you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. Let every kindred, every tribe on this celestial wall to him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all.
Well, I want to welcome you this morning to the Red River Meeting House here in Southern Kentucky, Logan County, Kentucky. This is the site of the beginning of the Second Great Awakening, the revival of 1800 that took place starting the third Sunday in June, or third weekend in June of 1800. And we're here to celebrate that momentous occasion. I welcome you to join me. As we are want to do, we want to begin with a psalm. And I've chosen today the first 15 verses of Psalm 77. I cry aloud to God, and he will hear me. In the day of my trouble, I seek the Lord. In the night, my hand is stretched out without wearying. My soul refuses to be comforted. When I remember God, I moan. When I meditate, my spirit faints. You hold my eyelids open. I am so troubled that I cannot speak. I considered the days of old, the years long ago. I said, let me remember my song in the night. Let me meditate in my heart. Then my spirit will make a diligent search. Will the Lord spurn forever and never be again favorable? Has his steadfast love forever ceased? Are his promises at an end for all time? Has God forgotten to be gracious? Has he in anger shut up his compassion? Then I said, I will appeal to this, to the years of the right hand of the Most High. I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your wonders of old. I will ponder all your work and meditate on your mighty deeds. Your way, O God, is holy. What God is great like our God? You are the God who works wonders. You have made known your might among the peoples. You, with your arm, redeemed your people, the children of Jacob and Joseph. Would you pray with me this morning? Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, it is an honor and a privilege to stand before you. It is an honor and a privilege to stand in a place where you did a mighty work 220 years ago. It is an honor and a privilege to know your Son, Jesus Christ, who died to grant us our salvation and the ability to spend eternity with you. And Heavenly Father, as we read this psalm and as we meditate on the events of our past, where we see the works that you have done, the wonders that you have performed, Heavenly Father, I ask that you guide and direct our thoughts. May you make us ever mindful of your presence, and may you open the scriptures to us so that we can learn more of you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for your Son. We thank you for your Spirit, which indwells us, which magnifies Christ in us. and convicts us of our sin. These things we pray, and as I am wont to pray, may the words of my mouth and may the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer, for it is in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Jesus, lover of my soul, let me to thy bosom fly. While the nearer waters roll, while the tempest still is high, hide me, O my Savior, hide, till the storm of life is past, safe into the haven guide. O receive my soul at last. Other refuge have I none, hangs my helpless soul on thee. Leave me not alone, still support and comfort me. All my trust in thee I stayed, all my help from thee I bring. Cover my defenseless head with the shadow of thy wing. Thou, O Christ, art all I want, more than all in thee I find. Raise the fallen, cheer the faint, heal the sick and lead the blind. Just and holy is thy name, I am all unrighteousness, vile and full of sin I am. Thou art full of grace and truth. Plenteous grace with thee is found, grace to cover all my sin. Let the healing streams abound, make and keep me pure within. Thou of life the fountain art, freely let me take of thee. Spring thou up within my heart, rise to all eternity.
We again want to go to the Lord in prayer, taking an opportunity to remember the requests that you have. The requests that you have sent me, the requests that you have made me aware of, and have posted as we've gathered together on these Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights. We want to remember to pray for those that are grieving, those that are suffering loss. We continually see the notification of those that have gone on to their eternity. And we pray for the families, those that are suffering. We pray for those that are ill, still suffering from the virus, still suffering from other diseases. We pray for peace. We pray for comfort. We pray for those having had surgeries, and we're aware of several recovering even as we speak and as we pray. And as I have instructed you in the weeks past, as I lead you today, bring your requests to the Lord. It is the Lord that hears and answers our prayer. It is the Lord that grants the thing that we are asking, the petitions that we are bringing, the thanksgiving that we are bringing to Him. So join me again as we pray. Heavenly Father, you instruct us to bring our concerns, to lay them at the foot of the cross. And Heavenly Father, may you help us that as we do that, we leave them there and walk away free indeed for having known you. We pray for those that are suffering. We pray for those that are grieving. There's still reports of even young folk that are leaving this life and leaving behind suddenly those that are suffering so, leaving a hole within our communities, Father. And we ask for healing. We ask for comfort. And we ask for grace. We ask for healing for those that have been under the doctor's care. We ask that you guide and direct in each of our lives, thanking you where we continually see you answer prayer, and thanking you for that. And as I draw this prayer to a close, would you pray with me that prayer that Christ instructed his disciples? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen and amen.
My faith has found a resting place, not in device nor creed. I trust the ever-living One, His wounds for me shall plead. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that He died for me. Enough for me that Jesus saves, this is my fear and doubt. A sinful soul, I come to Him, He'll never cast me out. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that He died for me. My heart is leaning on the Word, the written Word of God. Salvation by my Savior's name, salvation through His blood. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that He died for me. My great Physician heals the sick, the lost He came to save. For me His precious blood He shed, for me His life He gave. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that He died for me.
Well, again, as I mentioned in the introduction, I am standing in, as best we can determine by documentation that we have, that this is where the meeting house was. If you were to look out into the field in front of me, the patch of flowers out in the field is about 100 yards away and is the site of Mr. McPherson's apothecary shop. And again, a landmark that we have here. There's also a very curious feature back behind me, about 30 yards by 30 yards. Could this have been the site of the station, a Malding station? We don't know. We don't know exactly where the station was, but we do know that in 1865, I believe, there was a man preaching on the steps of the building that is where the reconstructed building is now. And that was a frame church that was built in 1835. And he said that nearby you could see the remains of the fort that protected the settlers in that time that they were here. So where we are standing is a historic place. It is a place that we revere. But we revere this not because of what the site is, but we revere this because of what God did in this place. The pastor that was had charge of this church and two others. 15 miles that way was Gasper River Church. 15 miles this way was Muddy River Church. And they were Presbyterian churches. James McGrady had the three. And it was their tradition. It was a Presbyterian tradition that one time a year they would have a sacrament service. Now, this is where all the congregations would gather together. It typically happened in this setting of the third Sunday of the month. And they would gather together here at Red River, at Gasper River, or at Muddy River, and they would hold their annual communion service. And this would be a service where McGrady or one of the other elders of the church probably would have gone around and visited everyone in his congregation and questioned them, do you have faith in Christ? To determine, are you a believer in our Lord Jesus Christ? And then he would present them with a communion token. And they would then redeem that token when they came to take the communion that particular weekend. So that is the setting of of why the crowd is gathered here. How many are gathered here? Well, we have grand visions here at Red River, the beginning of the camp meeting. And the best I can tell from the documentation is about 140. Now, you might say 140 is not a lot of people. Where's the thousands that we see the next year at Cane Ridge? Well, hold with me, because that's going to happen in a couple of months here in 1800. But 140, when the population of this area is nothing. there's nobody here. There's still nobody here. And even today, to get a crowd of 140 would be an astounding thing. Well, the revival of 1800 actually started about 1799. And I'm going to recount some of this from McGrady's own words. But immediately upon the commencement of the revival, we saw that there was criticisms that came up. Criticisms that said, well, you're holding church and that can't happen in church. That shouldn't happen in church. Oh, you can't do that. Now that just proves that your heart is not right. So McGrady answered that. And this is what I want to in part consider today. McGrady was a man of Scripture. He was a man of deep study. He read scientific things. I can tell this by reading the sermons that he wrote, that he delved into thinking. He was a thinking man, as it were. But he was also a very spiritual man. And when he preached, he opened the Word of God and preached the Word of God to his congregation. So it had to have been a grieving thing that McGrady would have come under this type of criticism. He begins his sermon quoting Matthew 11, and I'm going to expand just slightly on the scripture that he uses to give a little more context. Matthew 11, verses 1 through 6, when Jesus had finished instructing his 12 disciples, he went on from there to teach and preach in their cities. Now when John, as John the Baptist, heard in prison about the deeds of the Christ, he sent word by his disciples and said to him, "Are you the one who is to come, or should we look for another?" And Jesus answered them, "Go and tell John what you hear and what you see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up, and the poor have good news preached to them. And blessed is the one who is not offended by me." Whenever Christ appears for the salvation of sinners, it is in a manner contrary to the expectations of a blind world. It's in contrary to our own expectations. We come to a moment of salvation. We come to a moment of accepting the work of Christ on the cross, and we think, well, this is how it's going to be. And it is almost never that way. Because in our submission to Christ, we find that he lifts us up. When he made his appearance in the world, when he came in mercy to seek and save those which are lost, he did not appear in princely pomp. He did not appear as a man of means. But God veiled his Godhead in clay. And this is the clay of a bodily form that Christ was manifested here in us. He was so poor that he didn't have a place to lay his head. He was so poor that a miracle had to be done for him to be able to pay his taxes. And thus, it has been in every period of the church. Every period it has been that our expectations are something other than what Christ came to do when he came to save us. It is a humbling of our hearts. It is a humbling of our carnal minds. It is an abasing of our proud hearts that is necessary in order to come to the Lord. The Bible teaches us about how God worked. The Gospel of John that we're studying on Wednesday nights is showing us the signs and the wonders that were there to show who he was. Remember what he says to John, "What have you seen? The miracles that I've done. Believe on this basis, but don't believe in the miracle, believe in the Christ that the miracle is pointing to." Well, my brethren, in in similar fashion, we have come to this work of God that took place where I am standing. This work that is evident and is evidenced by the humbling of hearts. It is evidenced by the contrition of the people that have come. So we see, just like in the context of John the Baptist, wondering, Christ, are you the one that we're to look for? We are standing in this place going, is this truly a work of God? Is this something that God did in this place? Or is this something fabricated, something put together by man? Well, in discussing this, I would list to you some of what Mr. McGrady said in his sermon. Again, this is written in 1801. And he says, I design in speaking on this subject to prove that the powerful appearance of the revival of religion at present existing in our country is the work of God. And if possible, to remove every prejudice which might occasion some to be offended in Christ and hardened through unbelief. To obtain this point, he gives an outline, which I won't go through in completion, but he wants, in the first place, to give a brief statement of the present work of God. In the second place, to describe some of the effects which prove it to me to be a divine work of power. Thirdly, to account for many strange appearances which attended the work upon the principles of reason and of Scripture. And fourthly, the danger of being offended in Christ or indulging in the prejudice against the work of God. In the first place, to give an account of this present work. This blessed work first appeared in the Gaspar River congregation early in the spring of 1797. The doctrines of the new birth, faith, and repentance, which were uniformly preached, seemed to excite the imaginations, excite the hearts and souls of those that were in the congregations. Many asked, is religion a sensible thing? Can it be felt and known? If so, then there may be something wrong in my heart because I don't feel those things. We know that here in June of 1800, that there was a woman in the congregation in the middle of Reverend Hodges' sermon, that she stood and cried out seeking assurance of her salvation, something that she had not in her life up to that point considered, or she had not obtained up to that point. So the feeling that what he's preaching is one thing. What I'm not feeling is another. And is the problem with him, or is the problem with me? About the month of May, again, 1797, the work began to be visible. During the summer, a great many in that congregation were awakened, and 9 or 10 professed to experience the love of Jesus. Again, you know, 9 or 10, consider the congregation. What is it, 15 or 20? It's not a huge congregation. On the fourth Sabbath in July of 1798, the sacrament was administered at Gaspar River. On Monday, God poured out His Spirit in a remarkable way. The awakening work was very general, and there were but few families that were not in some way affected by the work, those that were seriously alarmed. At Muddy River, the first Sabbath in September, again of 98, the sacrament was administered. At this time, divine power seemed to attend the preaching of the Word, and a general solemnity was visible. About this period, the work spread throughout all the congregations. Deep concern in their hearts for their relationship with Christ. Deep concern over their own sin. Deep concern over their own apostasy. Well, in July of 1799, at the Red River Sacrament Service, here again where I'm standing, the power of God was manifested in a very general awakening of the unconverted. At the Gaspar River, at the end of the month of August, especially on Monday, God poured out His Spirit in a wonderful manner. Great numbers were struck to the ground and made to cry for mercy. Cry as the thief on the cross cried, knowing that his doom was coming. And in a few weeks, about 20 professed to feel living religion. At the Muddy River Sacrament in September, the power of God was equally visible. Sinners were powerfully awakened. A few precious souls were happily converted. This is what is happening. We're seeing God work, not in a flash in the pan. You understand what I'm saying there? Not a temporary thing, not a fast thing with no power, but He is working in a consistent way, bringing people to Himself. And then McGrady writes, in the year of 1800, the work appeared with greater power and produced greater effects than the present generation before witnessed. Well, here in June, third Sunday in June of 1800, again, where I'm standing, is where that sacrament service took place. That sacrament service would be one where they would set tables at the front of the church, and they would invite people to come and sit at the table, and they would serve the elements to the group at the table, and then they would have a little sermonette for each of the groups, and then they would depart, go back to the seats, and the next group would come up. Some sacrament services, one in Wales in particular, started at sunup and ended at sundown and could serve 100 people at a time. And that is a sense. Next year, 1801 in August, over at Cane Ridge, we know that 1,800 people came to take communion. We know this because of the number of communion tokens that were given out and presented. Again, we're looking at about 140 people here, and about 10 people professed to experience a living change in their hearts. At Gasper River, again, 1800, that's the next month, we see the congregation growing. We see the word spreading, and we see this, but don't forget that it is attended with preaching. It is the power of the Holy Spirit. But what is the Holy Spirit to do? The Holy Spirit is to magnify Christ in us. The Holy Spirit is to make what is undiscernible discernible. It is to also then convict us of sin. And here we come in to some of the criticisms that we would find. It is supposed that at Gasper River, 45 persons professed to obtain religion. At Muddy River, the work was equally powerful, about 50. At the Ridge, about 45, and at Shiloh, about 70. And McGrady gives us a little insight here. He said, time would fail to mention the progress of the work through the settlements of the Cumberland and the Barren along the banks of the Ohio, and to relate the circumstances of 1801 when he is writing this, because he says they are every bit as powerful. He will proceed on the second part to describe some of the effects and to prove that which proved to be the work of divine power. The first effect that he mentions is a deep and rational spiritual conviction. This is what doesn't just affect our emotion, but it cuts to the very core of the person. And here we see that while the emotion, the emotion that comes along with knowing the Lord, it does, and it's a blessed thing, but it comes from the core of our faith. He who is subject to this work is brought by the preaching of God's word to see the extent, the strictness, and the spirituality of His law. And by feeling conviction, he discovers that he has broken God's law days without number. He sees his life one continued scene of sin and rebellion against God, and we find that this conviction is of an increasing nature. The second thing notable about the revival is that feeling of deadness, that feeling of hopelessness, that feeling of being on the brink of destruction. It is delivered by the view of glory and the sufficiency and the willingness of Christ to save. Some of the criticisms of McGrady and the revival have been that when opposed to the First Great Awakening of the 1740s. We see the first great awakening bound in Scripture, bound in faith, headed by a man of faith and sincerity named Jonathan Edwards. But then the criticisms of the Second Great Awakening are it is an emotional thing. It is the opposite of the First Great Awakening. And this is not a historical truth. It is McGrady is preaching the same things Edwards is preaching. In fact, he is using Edwards' words on many occasions. The third effect produced by this work is a benevolent spirit. It is not a spirit of contention. It is a spirit of love. John writes in his epistles that unless we have love, we are not of Christ. If we say we have Christ in us and hate our brothers, then we're a liar and Christ is not in us. So here, the third effect and the third proof of this revival is that feeling of love spread abroad in their souls. Their hearts bled for those that were still suffering under the effects of sin. The fourth effect of the revival is an interesting one that McGrady recounts, and it is a knowledge of Christian doctrine and theology. It is a knowledge that, and this count is also attested by others that are writing in the period, that little children, and these are the words that McGrady uses, little children in coming to Christ are standing after their conversion, and they are telling in marvelous ways and in depth of the wonderful nature of Christ, the nature of their salvation, the nature of what Christ came to do. And McGrady says that in this telling that he himself is sometimes put to shame by the ability that these children had. A fifth effect of the revival is the effect that it produced on the hearts and lives of the genuine subjects of the work. To see him who frolicked and danced become the humble, praying Christian. To see the drunkard, the swearer, and the gambler leaping with praise and praising God and telling what the Lord had done for their souls. To see the profane scoffer at God in religion praying in secret, praying in his family, and walking in the ways of God's commandments. I say that, are not these the very things taken together? Are these not the blind that are seeing, the deaf that are hearing, and indeed the very dead that are being raised to life? We can see that what happened here was changed lives, and the lives were changed through coming in contact with Jesus Christ, coming in contact with the Word of God, coming in contact and being indwelt by the Holy Spirit, which is the gift that He gives us upon salvation. But the naysayers kept coming at Him, and they would say, well, again, this shouldn't be happening in church. These are Presbyterian folks. How can you do this in your church? And McGrady's answer, and my answer, is that what happened is plain in Scripture. Falling down. Do we see this happening in Scripture? Well, Paul fell down to the earth, trembling and astonished, and he said to the Lord, "What wilt thou have me do?" The jailer. Remember the jailer, when the gates were open and the prisoners could have gone, they didn't, and Paul says, "No, we're all still here." The jailer trembled and fell down and said, "What must I do to be saved?" Habakkuk in the Old Testament, speaking about the majesty of God, falls in God's presence. The prophet Daniel giving account of the discovery he had made of Christ, telling how he was affected, says, "There remained no strength in me." So falling doesn't disqualify us. It is not, I will contend, it is not something to seek, but it is something that will happen. And will be a joyous thing because of our relationship with Christ. Interesting statement that McGrady makes. He says that in these affections, in these exercises that he has criticized so much, he says that they are seeing God in that. And even in those that do not experience those manifestations, God is still at work. And we see this throughout the revival. Another objector says, "Well, I can't understand these vehement shrieks and hideous outcries." And again, it is who has not been in a dangerous situation that you have not cried out in fear? And what is happening here to us is what Edwards is talking about in his sermon, about a person being suspended over a deep pit filled with devouring flames by a small cord just ready to break. What would seem to him, would we not hear his screams and cry for deliverance? When Jonah goes through the city of Nineveh, the king of that place tells his people, cry out to the Lord. When we see various times in the scripture, we see people coming in contact with God. When they rebuild the temple, read Nehemiah, as they rebuild the temple, the sound of the rejoicing is heard for a long, long way. Another objector is going to say that this boisterous noise and confusion has nothing to do with scripture. Well, it has everything to do with scripture. And McGrady defines this. And defines this in a very, very important way. He says that these noises that you're hearing are after the service is over. The service is done in order, in accordance with the scripture. But as the people leave, they have questions, they have concerns, they have convictions. And the noise of the group, whether it's 140 or 3,000, as we'll see in a month or two, or 25,000, as we'll see in a year, the noise is going to be enormous. And is not something that is unscriptural. There's another evidence of the revival, of a thing that took place at this revival, and this is a criticism. I can believe that this is a criticism. And the objector says, there's another exercise among the people altogether new to me, that of persons being so deeply and painfully distressed about the sinners in their unconverted, or as they call it, dreadful state. That there would be this concern. We see this in Jeremiah. We see this in the Old Testament. We see this in the New Testament. That those that came to faith, Paul himself, read in Corinthians of the things that he suffered in taking the gospel to those that did not know. The call that Paul had there on the road to Damascus, to stand on your feet, and open the eyes of those that do not believe. And he carried this. Isaiah carried this. Jeremiah carried this. All the prophets carried this. Moses carried this same fervor. Joshua says to his people, decide this day whom you will serve, for as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. The Pentateuch is putting, the law is putting before the people, choose life. You have death, you have life. Choose life. Fifthly, many of these people, and as a criticism, many of these people pretend to act faith for others, and they are given comfortable answers in their prayer for conversion of other sinners. And again, this is something that is scripture, that we pray, bring your request to me, Paul writes, saying of Jesus, and the peace of God which passes understanding will keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. We pray in faith. James says the prayer of the righteous availeth much. So in our faith, we pray and we assume that the thing is done because God has promised so. Two other things that he's mentioning that we recount when it comes to this revival. The strange leaping and skipping about. Some are calling it David's dance. And another thing that's objectionable is the welling over and the strained agitations of the body. The skeptic would say this is nothing. There is nothing in this that is godly. And in the first part, David's dance, we're given David, and he danced, and he danced in the presence of the Lord, and it was because of what God had done, bringing the ark into the city, that David danced, not without criticism of his own from his own wife, but we see this happening over and over in Scripture. The lame man who was healed through the ministry of Peter and John at the beautiful gate of the temple is another example of a dance. He leapt up, he stood and walked and entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. An eighth objection that McGrady is recounting for us in 1801 is I frequently see those who possess a happy and comfortable countenance. They're frequently smiling and laughing. Such conduct, I think, too light and unbecoming of serious exercises of religion. And I will tell you that in the serious exercises of religion, it brings conviction, but it brings hope. It brings redemption. It brings forgiveness. One man writing about revivals said, revival is like judgment day. And that judgment that God brings on his people. The things leading up to the revival, the things leading up to the individual revivals was judgment. It was conviction. It was a realization of who we are. We're standing in the face of a holy God. And as Edwards said, we're standing as if suspended by a thread, held by the hand of a wrathful, angry God, who at his pleasure, not a word that we use in our present day, but at his moment of decision, the thing will be dropped. And then it will be destruction, or it will be glory to spend an eternity with Christ. Again, before I conclude this, I have to mention I have a couple of books here. You know that I like old books. And this is the book that this message came from. And it is a volume 2 of James McGrady's sermons. This is published in about 1833. It is published after the death of McGrady, some years earlier, and contains this. It contains sermons that are from the Word of God. But it also contains this, where God is doing a work, and we would stand and criticize God's work out of our own prejudice and out of our own disbelief. And again, we would hold up that difference of James McGrady is not Jonathan Edwards. Well, this book is published by Jonathan Edwards, and it is an early 19th century reprint, and the title of this is A Treatise on Religious Affections by the late Reverend Jonathan Edwards. Jonathan Edwards in the First Great Awakening saw people genuinely converted. He saw people that came to the Lord in conviction of their sin. He saw people that saw themselves in the face of a holy God. And he preached thusly. And he saw the same manifestations that McGrady saw. And so we can't separate the two. Either they are both a work of God, or they are neither a work of God. Now, before you think that I am glorifying the work, that I am glorifying the emotion, that I am glorifying the signs, let me point you back to 1645 with the Merrill of Modern Divinity, which Fisher tells us that we are to seek Christ. The benefit of knowing Christ is not the emotion that comes from knowing Christ. The benefit of knowing Christ is knowing Christ. It is knowing Him in His fullness. It is knowing Him, realizing who we are. And so, my friends, my brethren, whether it is the laughter or the dancing or the jerks, as some call them, or the running about or the boisterous noise, these are signs that God did a marvelous work here 220 years ago. But let us not seek the work other than the salvation that comes. Let us not seek the manifestations that come. They will come. But let us seek Christ, and let us seek Him in His fullness and in His glory, realizing again who we are, our sinful nature, our lost nature, our hopeless, helpless nature. But Christ came, and He shed His blood. He died upon that cross, And as I have preached, he entered into the Holy of Holies, not with the blood of lambs and goats and such, but with his own blood to make atonement for our sins. Zechariah said atonement would be made in one day for all the sins of the people. And that has been done. But we have one work to do. And that is, Jesus stands at the door and knocks. And if any man will open the door, he will come in and dine with him and live with him. We will know God through knowing Christ in his fullness. Would you pray with me? Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, again, to stand in such a place, to stand in such a place where you did a mighty work, to stand in such a place where sinners came and met you. Heavenly Father, this is the joy of this moment. But this is the lesson of this moment, that as I stand in this place, I can pray for revival. And I do pray for general revival. I pray for revival in the hearts of everyone watching. But the revival that I can affect is here. And as I draw a circle around myself here on these grounds at Red River Meeting House, standing in the original meeting house site, that my prayer is, God, revive everyone in this circle. We confess our sins. We see our need. We see the glory of the Savior. And we say, yes, I believe. This today is our prayer, and we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. I thank you again for joining me here this Sunday morning. It's been quite a privilege. And just like in 1800, now not so much at Red River, but at Gasper River and other places, we know that there were multiple preaching stands to accommodate the crowds. So as I am preaching here to you this morning, there's another group that is gathering. They're beginning to gather. The shofar has been blown, and they are joining together to worship the Lord. And so this is a joyous thing, and again a privilege to be here and in a little connection with the 18th century. Well, I would invite you again to join me Wednesday. Continually bring your request to the Lord. Pray, read your Bibles. This is our documentation. And I encourage you, read your Bibles. If no other reason than to say, well, Parson, that what you said, that wasn't just exactly right. I invite that. That's fine. But get into the Word of God. Pray. Pray without ceasing. And let me leave you with a benediction from 2 Thessalonians. And now may the Lord Jesus Christ Himself and God our Father, who loved us and gave us eternal comfort and good hope, through grace comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work and word. I look forward to seeing you Wednesday night, and I'll see you again next Sunday morning. Thank you.